So the first paper is on cover and decomposition in this calculus on elliptic curves made practical applications to a perfectly unreachable curve over FP6 by Anton Joux and Vanessa Witz. And you're ready.
Thank you. Stage is yours.
So this is quite a long title, sorry about that. So during this talk, I'm going to present you a new practical attack of the elliptic curve discrete logarithm problem. And give you an application to a curve which is defined over a sextic extension and to see how performant this attack can be. So, let me first begin with some reminding facts about the CDLP and the major existing attacks. Maybe first the definition of the DLP is the following. You are given a group G and two elements, G and H, in this group. And the goal is to find an integer when it exists, an integer x such that H is equal to G to the x. OK, so the difficulty of this problem is clearly related to the group G. And if you don't have any information, on this group, you can perform what we call a generic attack, which means that you consider the group law as a black box. And then the best complexity you can hope is in the, at least in the square root of the size of the group G. If you consider a specific instantiation of the group G, you may have some more efficient attack. For example, if G is a subgroup of a multiplicative group of a finite field, you can perform an index calculus method which has a sub-exponential complexity in L one-third. The function L is an interpolation function between polynomial complexity and exponential complexity. Or another example here is to take the subgroup of a Jacobian of a curve which is defined over a finite field FQ. Then, again, you can use index calculus method to be more performant than the generic attacks in the context where G, the genus of the curve, is greater than 2. For elliptic curves, the situation is a bit different. So I enunciate here the discrete logarithm problem in additive notation, and I give a sketch of the group law on this figure here. So you can see that this group law is quite easy to compute. You just use the equation of lines, but it is sufficiently intricate so that the DLP is very hard. Indeed, you usually only have generic attacks to attack this problem. The definition field of the field of the curve, you have the choice. You can take either a prime field. So in this context, you have an excellent security. But the difficulty here can be the arithmetic. If you want to have a fast arithmetic, it might be difficult in this context to implement it efficiently in hardware. So if you want to make the things faster, you might want to consider extension fields. Especially when p is equal to 2 or fits into a computer world. However, you have to be aware that in this context, these curves are potentially vulnerable to index calculus methods. So, as we have seen on this example, the index calculus methods are the best way to try to attack the ECDLP and to be faster than generic attacks. So I sketch here the basic outline of this method since it will be very important for the next of my talk. So the idea here is to first define a factor base which is composed of some points of the group G. And then you have two major stages. The first one is a relation search, where you consider random combination of the element G generated the group G and the target point H, which you want to compute the DLP, the DL. So you consider a random combination of G and H, and you try to decompose it in into the factor base. So once you have collected enough relations of this form, The idea is to combine them to try to conserve the right-hand side term, and then deduce the DL of H in base G. This can be reformulated by saying that, in fact, we are computing a vector in the kernel of the matrix composed by the, say, IG coefficients there. So the second stage of the index calculus method is the linear algebra 1, where we try to compute an element in the kernel of a huge matrix. So there are two difficulties when you're trying to do such index calculus method. The first one is on the practical side with this linear algebra. Matrices involved there are very, very huge, so usually several millions of columns. But hopefully, they are very sparse. Usually, you only have 10 or so coefficients which are non-zero per rows. So we can try to perform sparse linear algebra algorithms. The difficulty here is to distribute these algorithms. Okay. Either you use Lanczos or Wiedemann algorithm, but usually they are hard to distribute. The second difficulty is more a theoretical one. It concerns the search of relations. For example, if you consider an elliptica which is defined over a prime field, we don't know any method yet to compute the relations. As I said, if you consider an elliptica which is defined over an extension field, in this context you have two existing methods. The first one, in fact, consists of transferring the problem to another group, the group of defined by the rational points, the FP rational points, of the Jacobian of a curve C. So you use a very decent technique to transfer the DLP on this group, and then we perform an index calculus method. Or the second method can be to try direct decomposition on the elliptic curve using Gaudry and Deems approach. So, as it is really important for the talk, I will detail a bit these two methods right now. So the first one, very decent, consists of first taking the very restriction of the elliptic curve E, which is defined over an extension field FQ to DM. So this is just an abelian variety which whose equations are obtained by considering equation of E seen on the vector space FQN over FQ. So you have n equations defining this very restriction. And then what we do is we consider a curve C which is included into this very restriction and which is defined over FQ. So somehow this inclusion is equivalent to say that we're considering a morphism pi from the curve, the FQn rational points of C to the FQn rational points of E. So once you have this cover map, you do the transfer by considering the following applications. First, the pullback of the pi morphism to go to the Jacobian of C defined over FQ to the n. And then the trace map with respect to the extension FQn over FQ to get to transfer the DL into the Jacobian of C defined over FQ. Then you perform an index calculus method on this last group, and you can do this either in two ways. Either you consider a hyper-elliptic curve C which has a small genus, and then you can use Gaudry's method. Or if the curve has a small prime degree model, you can use Deems' algorithm. But in any case, you need to have a curve which has a small genus G. And the question and the main difficulty in this approach is to find such a curve. So to do that, we can use the GHS construction, which is due to Gaudry, S, and Smart in the binary case, and which has been generalized by Deem in the odd characteristic case. So the idea of this method here is to, given an elliptic curve E, which is defined over FQn, and an equation of this curve, to construct the curve C defined over FQ and the corresponding morphism from C to E. I won't detail the method since it's quite complicated, but I would like to mention that for most elliptic curves, the genus that you obtain with this construction is in 2 to the m. So clearly, the index calculus method that you can perform on the Jacobian of C are usually slower than the direct generic attacks performed on the elliptic curve. You can nevertheless use an isogeny walk to extend the reach of this attack. This is a method proposed by Galbraith, by Stephen Galbraith. But still, this method is usually efficient only for a few fields. So if this doesn't work, you can try to perform a decomposition attack directly on the elliptic curves. And this was proposed by Gaudry and Dim. So here you don't do any transfer. And since the method is working also in a more general case of Jacobian of curves, I will present it in the context of Jacobian of a hyperelliptic curve defined over f q to the m. Okay, so usually you apply this to the elliptic curve, but I present it in the context of hyperelliptic curve. So the idea here is to define the factor base by considering the divisor of the Jacobian of H over FQn, which have this form here. So they are equivalent to a point Q, which has a next coordinate which lies in FQ. Okay, in the elliptic case, this means that you are considering points having an x coordinate in FQ. And then you perform the relation search step. So you try to decompose a given arbitrary divisor as a sum of ng elements of the factor base, where ng here is precisely the dimension of the very restriction of the Jacobian of H. So if you look at the asymptotic complexity, you have a relation search step which is in has a complexity in big O of Q, and linear algebra which has a complexity in Q square. So you can rebalance a little bit the things by using a double large prime variation, and then you get an asymptotic complexity which is in Q to the 2 minus 2 over ng as Q grows to the infinity and n and g are fixed. So the advantage of this method is that all curves are equally weak under this attack, which is not the case for the GHS attack. But the decomposition here is the main problem, because each time you try to decompose a given divisor, you will have to solve a multivariate polynomial system over a finite field, which is quite difficult in practice. So we can see a bit of detail about this decomposition stuff. To try to get the decomposition of D into ng elements of the factor base, what we do is we use the approach of Nagao, which consists of looking for a function f whose divisor is equal to this expression here, which means that we are trying to find f in a Riemann-Rohr space defined by this divisor here, ng times the point at infinity minus d. Okay, so this reformulation, in fact, is can be seen as parametrization by the Riemann-Rohr space of the set of decomposition of the divisor D. So once you try to find the function f, you can see that as you need to have the x coordinate of the q point to lie in fq, you will have to solve a quadratic polynomial system defined over FQ, which is composed by this number of variables there, and this number of equations, just expressing the fact that the x-coordinates of the Q points are in FQ. So this is clearly a zero-dimensional quadratic polynomial system, and we can estimate the complexity of its resolution by saying that it's at least polynomial is the degree of the zero-dimensional ideal, which is 2 to the a minus 1 times ng, which is exponential as in n ng. So in practice, the resolution of this polynomial system is really difficult, and mainly, we are able to get a resolution only when n and g are smaller than 3, or eventually, if you consider the elliptic case using semi-summation polynomials, you are able to make the resolution when n is less than 5. Okay, and as you need to collect about Q relations for the linear algebra step, you will have to compute about factorial NG times Q decomposition polynomial systems, or even more if you are trying to perform the double Lagrange prime variation I mentioned before. So the bottleneck of this approach is clearly that the relation search is too slow for a practical resolution of the DLP. Okay. So during the second part of the talk, I will present our new index calculus method. And the first ingredient of this method is clearly to try to improve the situation with the relation search. So what we do here is that we consider relations involving only elements of the factor base. So relation of this form. And if you make some heuristic about how many such relation we have, you can see that it's about q to the m minus ng over factorial m, so that we need to fix the parameter m to ng plus 2, right, to have enough relation to perform the linear algebra step. Okay, so this is quite similar, in fact, to what we are doing in the classical index calculus methods on finite field, with, for example, the number field sieve or the function field sieve. Or if you are familiar with DIM's MTEX calculus method for small degree plane curves, it's also the same stuff. Okay, so of course you have to modify the index calculus method in this context. During the linear algebra step, what you compute is just the DR of the elements of the factor based up to a constant now. So that to compute an individual discrete log, you will have to perform at least two Nagoside decomposition to fix this constant. So this is the what we call the descent phase. And if we want to compare now the decomposition search in Nagao and in our variant, we see that in Nagao's approach, we have many polynomial system, quadratic polynomial system to solve, which are zero dimensional. And whereas in our variant, we have only one polynomial system, which is underdetermined, with two more variables than the number of equations. So what do we have more with our what is best with our approach is that if you are able to compute a nice set of generators of the ideal of this polynomial system, you might be able to compute faster the relations. The idea is to compute a lexicographic Gomner basis, hoping that the specialization of the two more variables that we have yields an easy-to-solve system. So the things are going very well when we are considering the special case where the curve is defined over a quadratic extension field. We are considering the odd characteristic case here so that we can define the extension as this, where omega is a non-square. And in this context, what is nice is that you have an additional structure on the equations. In fact, the polynomials involved at each decomposition are multi-homogeneous. In fact, they are even bilinear. If you consider the variables with respect to the first block of this degree, you get one-dimensional variety. So in practice, we modify the decomposition method by not specializing two variables, but instead we specialize the first block of variables, so that all the remaining variables now are lying in a one-dimensional vector space. So this is really easy to solve, of course. We'll see in a minute that we can further improve the situation by using a sieving technique. In practice, this is much faster than Nagao's approach. For example, if you consider the case where n is equal to 2 and the genus is equal to 3 on a 150-bit curve, we are about 1,000 times faster than Nagao's approach. Okay, so let's now detail a bit the sieving technique. The fact is that here, after the decomposition method, what you get is a polynomial whose roots are supposed to be the x-coordinate of the cube point in the decomposition of your divisor D. So you still need to find the roots of this this polynomial and to test if it splits. So to do that, we in fact prefer to modify the decomposition stage by saying that during the specialization of the first block of variables, we can express all the remaining variables in terms of the last unknown lambda that you have. So that the polynomial big F here is in fact a polynomial in the variable x and lambda, and has degree 2 in lambda, and degree 2g plus 2 in x, corresponding to the 2g plus 2 points in the decomposition of t. So instead of specialization lambda, we do an enumeration in x over fq, and look at the corresponding values in lambda, which are easier to compute because it's a polynomial of degree 2. And what we do so is that we store in tabular a counter associated to each values of lambda. And after the enumeration in x, we are looking for the counters which have reached the value 2g plus 2, because we know then that for these values of lambda, the polynomial f is split. Okay, so this is a classical trick that we are doing in sieving techniques. In particular, this method is well adapted to the double large prime variations I mentioned, since in this context you only have to sieve with respect to the values of x corresponding to the small primes. Okay, so this was the first ingredient, improve the decomposition step, decomposition computation. The second ingredient is to use a combined attack of the GHS and the decomposition attack. So we are considering the context of an elliptic curve defined over fq to the n, where the finite field is such that the GHS does not provide any nice covering curve. Typically, the genus of C is too large to perform an efficient index calculus method. And the degree of the extension n is too large, namely greater than 6, to have a practical decomposition attack. So in this context, we are a bit stuck. So what we can do is to suppose that the degree n is composite. If n is composite, then we can apply both approaches. First, the GHS on the subextension fqn over fqd, and then transfer the DL to a Jacobian of the curve C defined over fqd, then performing the decomposition attack on this Jacobian of C. We respect this time to the field, the base field FQ. Note, you can note here that the degree, the composite degree is not artificial since it has been proposed for optimal extension fields. So we can have a look at the case where n is equal to 6, the sextic extension case, which occurs for optimal extension field. And an ideal target in this context is to consider a curve E which has a genus 3 hyperelliptic cover. Okay, so this occurs in fact for about q to the 4 curves directly up to isomorphisms. And if you allow you to use an isogeny walk, you can say that at least we conjecture that it's true for almost all curves having a cardinality divisible by 4. In this context, if you try to apply the GHS attack or the decomposition attack, you get something which is not efficient, since the best you can get with the GHS attack is a genus 9 cover. And this occurs rarely, only for q to the cube, q to the 3 curves. Sorry. So index calculus methods in this context are usually slower. And as I said before, as the degree of the extension is 6 here, the direct decomposition will fail. So we can have some estimation based on computation done with the Magma software in the context where the curve E has a prime subgroup, a prime order subgroup of 160 bits. So if you try to perform a generic attack on this curve, against this curve, You have an asymptotic complexity which is in P cube. And if you try to extrapolate the timings that you can obtain in this context, you see that the global attack would take 50 trillion of years, so clearly unreachable. Now, if you try to perform a decomposition attack or the GHS attack, you have two choices. You can either consider FP square for the base field. In this context, you can see that the memory is the bottleneck, since you have to store about P square elements. So clearly unreachable with P of 27 bit size. Or you can try to use FP as a base field. So in this context, as already said, decomposition is intractable, and the GHS attack in the best case allows you to perform an attack with an asymptotic complexity in P to 7/4. In practice, this would take about 1,500 years. So this is not so bad, but occurs very rarely. Now you can try to perform our cover and decomposition attack. So here the complexity, the asymptotic complexity is nicer. It's in P 5/3. Of course, in the case where the curve admits the genus free hyperelliptic cover. And the estimation here would take about 750 years using Nagao's decomposition style. So this is already much better. Or even 300 years using the modified relation search. So, but this is clearly just estimation. So we can now have a concrete example that we with a real size example, I mean. So we consider an elliptic curve which belongs to the family of curve admitting a genus-free hyperelliptic cover. So it has this form. And we took a curve which has a cardinality which is 4 times a prime number of size here, 148 bits. If you perform the GHS attack against this curve, you get a cover which has a genus 33. So clearly unreachable. And now if you try to perform our method, we were able to get a complete resolution of the DLP in about 1 month. So I can a bit detail the timings here. During the relation search, we first have to compute the lexicographic Gumbner basis. This took about 3 seconds, really fast. Just to mention, if you try to compute the lexicographic Gumbner basis for a random system with the same number of equations and variables, which is quadratic, you're not able to do the computation. Okay, so this is really fast. Then you have the sieving step. So here we have computed all the possible relations, which means P to 2 or 2 times factorial H relations. And this took about 62 hours using 124 cores. So as already said, it's 1,000 faster than Nagao's approach. Then we have the linear algebra step. So as we have many more relations than needed, we first used the strategic Gaussian elimination to reduce by a factor of 5 the number of columns. And this took about 25 hours using 32 cores. And then the main step, the Lanczos algorithm step, which took about 1 month using 64 cores. So at this point, I would like to mention that somehow we cannot more improve this step using Lanczos algorithm, because we have to broadcast about 200 megabytes of data at each round, which is somehow the bottleneck for parallelization. Okay, maybe Antoine can say more on this during this talk in 1 hour. And finally, you still have to do the descent phase, where you have to compute an individual logarithm, and this is really immediate since it took about 14 seconds for 1 point. Okay, finally, I would like to see a bit how we can scale again the timings obtained with Magma before, using all the experiments that we have done on different curves. So we have 3 examples here. case where we have a curve of 136 bits, 142 bits, and the last case I've presented. So you can see that the ceiling times it's each time is about 5 times longer, and the Lanczos time is about 3 times longer. So that extrapolating this value, we can say that completely breaking the DLP over a 160 bit curve would take about 200 CPU years. So better than one I have announced in the during the previous slides. Okay, I will end this talk here. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks, Vanessa, for the great talk. Is there any question or any remark? We have a lot of time. All right, let's start here. Ed?
In most index calculus algorithms, finding additional discrete logs is much easier than finding the first one. Is it also the case in your algorithm?
Could you repeat the beginning of the question, please?
In many index calculus algorithms, it is easier to find additional discrete logs after you have done the hard work and found the first discrete log and calculated.
Sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Ah, okay. Okay. Sorry, I didn't get the question. Sorry.
Is there any other question? Nigel is waving, but anybody else? Nigel.
Hi. Very impressive timings. Do you have any feeling how this could be extended to characteristic two?
Yeah. Actually, it's a good question. Okay. So we have done some experiments as well in characteristic two, and this can be also applied in this context. But you have some specific situation in characteristic two with also the same F's summation polynomials. So we are actually working on this case to improve the situation. So maybe direct decomposition is also a good approach in this context.
Any other questions? Please stand up and wave clearly. It's hard to see anybody. Okay, Vanessa, thanks again for
Thank
the
you.
Nice talk.